Yes, sir. Good. Shrutinjal.
Shrutinjal, sir, yes.
Slightly different kind of name. Shrutinjal Narayan. What a Shrutinjal. Shrutinjal. Okay. You were working in NASCO.
That's right, sir.
Why did you leave that? It's a good job, project manager, NASCO.
So,
on India level.
So I was working with the social arm of NASCOM, sir, which is NASCOM Foundation, and I was specifically working in a skill development project, which was a CSR project funded by Genpact, which is a multinational company. And when I was actually working in the skill development space, I had a lot of opportunities to go meet with multiple stakeholders, which included the training partners, student, end beneficiaries, and a lot of people. And somehow I realized that the social sector and the development sector is something that I'm very interested in. And I thought that the government at scale is something that can actually add impact and value. And which is why I thought that it actually makes a logical sense to enter the government.
So that is the reason for you coming to IAS? You want to get into IAS mainly for the social system?
Actually, yes, sir, to be honest. And I was always intrigued by the IAS because I don't have any friends, any family who've been part of the governance system. And
but you may never work in social sector.
I didn't understand, sir.
You may never work in the social sector.
In the development sector per se, where you're actually impacting lives of a larger number of people through the government schemes and welfare projects, that is something that I'm looking forward to.
You're a very religious person.
Yes, sir.
Religious or spiritual?
I think I would call myself spiritual, but it was actually someone who's very interested in rituals as well. So I wouldn't, so that's how I would define myself.
So how many temples have you been?
I've been to over about 150 odd temples in total. But specifically, I've done 87 out of the 108. Sir.
Another 21 to go.
21, but I think 2 is outside the earthly realm, so probably 19 more.
Okay. So 19,
yes, sir.
Your physical life. Okay,
that's right. Sir.
Okay. So what do you find fascinating about this? Is it again a ritual, or is it does it have some some meaning?
So I think when I was young, I think the geography of the space, a large number of these temples are located around Thanjavur, Trichy, around Madurai. And the geography of each of these places is very interesting, including Badrinath, which I visited alone when I was working at NASCOM Foundation, in fact. And stories associated with each of these, specific rituals, how it actually includes various elements of the geography, culture, society of that area, and how it's all been packaged so beautifully for that. To just give you an example, the kind of food or the festival that probably happens along the coast of Tamil Nadu will be very different from what is actually practiced in Badrinath because of the coastline availability here, where there are rituals associated with the sea, associated with the Kaveri, the river, because it happens to be the delta. And up north, if you go, how they venerate Ganga in that area, a lot of folk deities around the mountains. So I've always been fascinated by the stories and rituals.
No, but the basic thing is that, you know, all these temples and all were built in prosperous areas where there were deltas, and if you go to most of your temples.
Yes, sir.
It is mostly in Thanjavur, Trichy.
Yes, sir.
And you could take Tamravarani Basin.
That's right.
It's all where the water is. So what is, and what, with available material, like you said, the coastline,
Right.
Food will be different from interior food, naturally, because the availability is different.
Right.
So it's about the availability of food. Is that so fascinating? Different foods are available in different places.
I think when we're talking about, let's say, localization and concepts like, we have GI tags currently in India, where we're actually promoting local handicrafts, local handlooms, contextualizing even governance to the area in today's world, like how are cities managed, how are economics developed based on what is available in those spaces. Of course, with addition to labor and other economic parameters, but just how they were packaged and how the tradition still continues for so long. And we have businesses that hardly survive for few years, but some of these traditions have survived for so many years, which includes many communities. It's not just one or two communities, but the involvement of multiple stakeholders and how these traditions have survived for so long is something that I'm very fascinated about.
Do you think that this, you know, there was a time when, you know, religion was a little, you know, subdued. Religious activity in this country was a little subdued.
Right.
There was more of political activity.
Right.
But I think there is again a revival of this religious activity, which is not, which is a little, you know, which gives a lot of apprehensions to a lot of people. Do you agree with that?
Absolutely. I think I would agree to the extent that as long as religion is something which is personal and it's not, it's something that's practiced and it's not enforced upon on other people without impinging on the rights or the dignity of other people. I think as a very personal experience, endorsing the cultural diversity of this country and promoting a sense of harmony, a sense of well-being, and a sense of personal seeking of ethical righteousness, which is what is dharma, I think to that extent it is in a way a strength of our country which needs to be nurtured. But in terms of it becoming delving into other areas is something that I would probably not be for.
Is that in any way disturbing? Is there a disturbing trend in this society to, you know, make religion an issue?
So I think to that extent, when it, I think yes, sir. For me personally, I think religion, when it's going to cause, especially in a secular republic like our country, when it's going to cause divisions among people, I think when the state is involved, when the state has to deliver public services and enforce rule of law and protect and safeguard the interests of everybody, I think it is important that religion is kept to the private sphere and not much in the public, in the political arenas.
Oh,
Sustanjay
Narayan.
That's right.
It's interestingly, in your extracurricular activities, obviously, it's a Carnatic movie, visiting temples with an interest in 108 Vaishnavite Divyadesas.
That's right.
Have you visited any mosques, churches, or Sikh shrines, or Jain temples?
Yes, sir. So when I was in Delhi, one of the places that I used to visit a lot was the Humayun's tomb and the Nizamuddin Dargah. So I visited Sufi mosque, I visited the Jama Masjid, I visited the Ajmer shrine, and I've also visited, you asked about Sikh shrine, I visited the Golden Temple, the Harmandir Sahib in Amritsar.
So this temple visit is a regular part of your ritual or practice every month?
For women, sir.
This temple visits.
Yes, sir.
It's a regular practice which you are undertaking every week or every month.
Yes, sir. So over the last few years, I've always been visiting temples. So why it's a hobby is, I think if you just leave me, I think it's kind of my personal space where my parents are not very regular temple goers, but I've always been a very regular temple goer. But over time, I've also gotten a little bit into yoga, so I've gone more into meditation when I go to temples now. So.
You mentioned that your father and mother are into business.
That's right, sir.
Business, yeah.
So my father is in the media field. We run an event management and an event production company. And my mother runs an after-school activity center in Chennai.
So both of them are self-employed business?
Both of them are self-employed.
Okay. What business your mother is involved?
She runs an after-school activity center.
After-school activity?
After-school activity. Okay. So she nurtures hobbies like music, art, chess, and karate for children between 9 and 14 years. And so it's after-school, like, in the evenings where the kids come.
You've got an interest, looks like a strong interest in religious or spiritual, whatever you call it.
That's right, sir.
I'll make a statement, just comment on it. One can be an atheist and still be in Hinduism. Is it correct?
Absolutely, sir. I think there have been many times when I myself question if there is God when I look at many things around me, and I think it's absolutely possible to be an atheist and to be a Hindu.
But is this the situation other with Christianity or in Islam?
Is this the
situation in Christianity or in Islam?
is asking whether you can be an atheist.
You can be an atheist and you still call yourself a Christian.
I am actually not very sure, sir. Not very sure.
See, your basic degree is geo
informatics.
Yes, sir.
In simple terms, can you describe what is the subject?
So geoinformatics is basically using it in simple terms. I think it's the science of where is something, where is something happening. I think that is in most layman terms, where is this place, where is this incident happening, where do we find this resource. So I think GIS essentially uses location data, and we have imagery or observational data which can be satellite, it can be a camera. I think it's the imposition of two which is basically geoinformatics.
So in that background, I'm asking you a question.
Yes, sir.
This March, this month, in 2014, an important event took place. It was March 8th. What was it? The science was not able to find out the reason for it.
I'm not.
It's connected with your subject, that's right. What I'm asking. March 2014. The date is 8th, when the subject of correction.
I'm not able to read.
The disappearance of MH370, the flight.
Right.
You heard about it.
Yes, sir.
It is one of the puzzles even now in civil aviation
studies. That's right, sir.
Since you are a student of geoinformatics and you have mentioned in simple terms
right.
about what geoinformatics is all about,
right,
can
sir.
You tell us what are all the possible theories of the disappearance of the passenger flight, which science was not able to find out? Even now, in spite of scanning more than 1.5 lakhs of
kilometers
in the sea, there are cloud funding and other things.
Right. So I think the possibility of locating, which I think
yes.
is something, I think because of the dynamism of the Earth itself and the process, and the flight was actually lost somewhere in the southern Indian Ocean, which is an extremely turbulent and a dynamic part of the world. So if a crash had happened, and because of just the atmospheric and climatic conditions at that point, it's quite possible that it was not just located in one place, and it's quite possible that just the fragmentation of the unit would something be very difficult in a sense to kind of locate, even with the kind of resolution of data that we currently have. So.
Can we ever find out the truth at some point of time?
I think
possible.
Yeah, I think it's. I would not rule out the possibility, but I'm not sure how probable it is.
It's very interesting to listen to you, your interest in visiting places of worship, which I think you also brought in the idea that it's not just a very abstract religious sentiment, but also
right.
your desire to connect people's
right.
way of habits, their community living. And I think this is one reason that cultural geography has emerged as a sub-discipline, and in India it is picking up.
Right.
So it's really wonderful to listen to you that. And I don't know how much you have thought about cultural geography as a discipline,
mm-hmm.
which I think is very important perhaps in civil servant,
sure.
because it also brings in hermeneutics, philosophy, phenomenology,
absolutely.
And even cognitive science, you know, and understanding geography, not in a very cartographic manner, but
right.
in a community living.
Sure.
So have you thought about some of these multidisciplinary aspects? Which it looks like you already embed in your thinking and in your interest in visiting places of worship.
Right, so, right, Mama, as you said, I think cultural geography is definitely a space that's currently emerging, and I think I've actually thought about it more from an economic sense,
okay.
In terms of how district administration can properly leverage some of these, I would even say some of these best practices in kind of governance where multiple communities are involved and they are made stakeholders in certain projects and how that's actually worked in many areas. I would also look at it in terms of the potential we have for heritage tourism, or we have pilgrimage-based circuits that are coming up. We have the Ramayana circuit, we have the Prasad and the Hriday scheme. So I've thought about it in those streams. And in a sense, I think I don't think we have, we don't have for sure a Divya Desam circuit in Tamil Nadu. So I think there is potential to probably harness the economic value of it in Tamil Nadu. And that extent I talk about.
Yeah. He is very unique, and you also do a unique work, unique interest. How do you mean he has this intent? How is Surur?
Shrutanjay. It means celebration of victory, sir.
Okay, your mother tongue is Tamil. You wrote exam in Hindi. Why?
Sir, I studied in an ICSE school, and I'm from Chennai, born and brought up. But I think my mother is also half North Indian. My grandfather is from Lucknow. My father is actually from Andhra Pradesh, but I've been born and brought up in Chennai. So in some sense, I think I'm a
India.
Son of India for sure.
Right, okay, fine. Okay, you studied this geoinformatics for 4 years.
That's right.
Fine. How you can use this in your service, wherever you are posted? For example, if you are posted in a place, it's very, very crowded. Or how drought grown to say, like you are posted in Ramna in Tamil Nadu.
Right.
How your education skill can, you know, improve the state in all aspects, especially in agriculture, forest, how will you do that?
Right, so one area in which remote sensing is currently used is in integrated watershed management.
Yes.
So now when you actually have the combination of, let's say, you can use satellite data to kind of understand the drought prone area of a particular region, I can map the meteorological patterns of that particular region, I can map soil moisture.
Yes.
Based on which, let's say if there is an integrated water development project, you can use e-governance, you can use geotagging. So let's say there's MNREGA work.
Yeah.
And we're actually going to be using people to create check dams, to actually reclaim ponds, to actually work on organic farming or precision agriculture in that particular region. I think GIS is going to be useful for geotagging. It's going to be useful probably to even use drones for mapping. It's going to be used for a lot of these things.
Yeah, when you said about drone, one of the accountant general in Tamil Nadu 2 years back, he used a drone to find out how much sand was quarried from a river. Right, it's again unique when you would say about this, how the GIS can be really useful. But still, we have scientifically improved a lot, but still we are not, though our PSLV system very good and then our launching also very good, but in the spatial, we are not up to date like other countries. Like even you take developed countries like US and Russia.
Right.
Even Israel, they are very good about it.
Sure.
It's a small country. But we have a capability,
right,
but we are not able to achieve it.
Right. So I think it's a very unique situation because I think geoinformatics is very intuitively coming to people with the use of Ola and Uber and very everyday examples. I think it's something that's actually coming into people's hands already. So I think if it's democratized to the sense, if we're going to use the GIS knowledge in geography at a much younger age, I think innovations and applications based on Indian context, now we've already used it, let's say, for commuting, right? In other areas, like you said, agriculture,
yeah,
governance, land resource management, I think if we have a lot more entrepreneurial zest in that area, I think we can definitely improve a lot. And I think one area which we're also working on and is working is grievance redressal and in the area of solid waste management. So the C-Vigil app, which the Election Commission of India used during the Model Code of Conduct last year, I think there was a lot of example of how crowdsourcing information from citizens to understand this is where a problem is, and then you had officers come in and ensure that there was...
No, all those things. No. I am asking how we could not take up. See, all
right,
technologies, we have a technology, we have a launching, and everything is there.
Right.
But GPS and GLONASS are like how they took off long back. But why our NAVIC system could not really take off? The ambitious project of NAVIC, it took place long back.
Right.
Right. But still, it did not take off in the practical terms. What IR analysis?
Yes, the IR analysis.
So I think in that sense, because of the efficiency that GPS has already been able to
They established well.
establish very well, I think the benchmark with respect to GPS was something that was. But I think it's a very important and a good challenge for India to actually, A, from a national interest perspective, and B, also from an opportunity perspective in terms of developing sense of scientific temper and entrepreneurship. I think it's an important challenge which I think ISRO is taking up quite seriously, I think.
Right.
Sukhajai,
Yes, sir.
you are studying liberal studies.
That's right, sir.
So naturally, a question arises. Is there any diploma in conservative studies?
I don't know.
Is there a diploma in conservative studies?
Conservative studies.
3 degrees.
I'm not
Very
very
good.
aware, sir, but I think recently there are courses which are talking a lot more about culture, about indigenous values, about there's a new fellowship that's in fact going to come up this year.
So what do you study in this course, liberal studies?
So I did my geoinformatics, and when this was the third year when the YIF was actually launched, I think there was a very, very, very inspiring set of faculty that was actually available at that time at the Young India Fellowship, and it was offering a very, and I was very interested in actually learning the human sciences at that time, social sciences. I've been born and brought up in Chennai, and something that I wanted to experiment is the reason why I did the fellowship, sir.
In this 108 temples,
Yes, sir.
108 temples,
Which are temples?
9 temples are called Navatirupati temples.
That's right, sir.
Where are these?
The Navatirupati temples are in the Tamrabarani basin, as sir was talking about, and primarily around where the prominent Alvar there is Nammalvar. So around Alvar Tirunagiri, the temples are called Navatirupati.
Some civil servants are having some marks in their forehead.
Right, sir.
Their personal belief should be respected, I agree. But as a civil servant, do you think it is right?
My personal belief would be that I think you should still allow personal beliefs to the extent that that is not going to delve into the role that they're going to be performing. But I think marks and insignias is something which I think the Honorable Supreme Court has also allowed, and I think that should be continued, sir.
Can the public differentiate between personal and professional qualities of a person?
For sure, sir. I think with the way of, with the, I think conduct definitely will make a difference in how a person perceives personal versus professional conduct, sir, for sure.
Our constitution was enacted at the time of great insecurity in our country. Do you agree? Our constitution was enacted at the time of great insecurity in our
I wouldn't say insecurity. I think at a time of visible differences which had to be reconciled when you're creating a new nation.
Are we secure now? What's the difference between 1947 and 2020?
I think in a democracy, there's always going to be some kind of churn or problem, but to a large extent, I think we have progressed in terms of maintaining a lot of social harmony, building public institutions, and ensuring a lot of remarkable development over the span of the 70 years in the epoch that we're currently living
in. In 2002, this March 1, something happened somewhere. Do you know about it?
I'm not sure of the.
2002. March.
I'm not very aware of the date. If you could probably explain what the event is, I'm not able to remember what the particular event is on March 1st in 2002.
Okay. In the continuation of my questions, you can guess.
Right.
Constitution was enacted at the time of great insecurity.
Right.
In our country.
Mm-hmm.
Are we secure now? What's the difference between 1947 and 2020?
Right.
In 2002, something happened somewhere.
Right.
From February 28, 29 to?
I'm not sure, but I think one of the events that happened in 2002 were some of the unfortunate and tragic events that happened in Gujarat.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, right?
Thank you, sir.
We'll call you in 2 minutes.
Please sit down.
Thank you.
See, we are all quite happy with the way you, you answered the questions.
Thank you.
Your confidence level, your communication ability, and your knowledge of what you have put down in your resume. Okay. So, I don't think there is any problem on all those accounts.
Okay, sir.
But I think you didn't even say good morning to anybody. We have no problems with that. But
okay.
Sometimes the board may, some of the board members may not be very happy with that. So, a basic courtesies is extend to the chairman and the board.
Okay.
So, when you go in, you say good afternoon, good morning, whatever it is.
Okay, sir.
And normally they indicate that you please sit down.
Sure.
You can take, So, I think otherwise, I think you came out very well.
Thank you, sir.
Hmm? So you do very well. When is your interview?
March 24th.
24th. Oh, all of them on that date. 20th, 23rd, 24th. I think today people have been coming. So you can go with a lot of confidence.
Okay, sir.
Because you come out as a very mature person who is, who has a fairly decent understanding of, the issues and at least the things that you have put down in your other side. Of course, we have not actually asked you any question on current affairs.
Right.
We have not asked you a lot of questions on, what is happening. But your attitudes are good. So that should, if you are lucky, you will get questions like this.
Right.
That should carry you through. Right. But you should, of course, don't be complacent.
Okay.
Prepare for the, current affairs.
Sure.
Okay. Otherwise, I think it was very good.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
There are many questions around Carnatic music.
Okay.
And Vaishnava.
Depends on the
panel.
But I think we'll be prepared for them.
Okay.
Carnatic music, because there are heavyweights.
Right.
Who know these things much better than many of us. So.
Okay.
So there can be questions on that, but I think your positive attitude I think should see you through.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. All the best.
Thank you.
Yeah.